Stress Adaptation Theory under Supervision of دكتورة معالي المالكي Professor of Psychiatric and Mental Health Nursing Minofia University Assistant Professor دكتورة مواهب محمود زكي Assistant Professor of Psychiatric and Mental Health Nursing Banha University Prepared by Iman Ahmed Shalabi Psychiatric Department Second Master Degree Faculty of Nursing Banha University. First, the outline. Introduction, definition of stress, causes of stress, effects of stress on body system, stress theory, stages of general adaptation syndrome, stress management techniques, nursing management for stress. The introduction. Nowadays, it can be said that stress is a global phenomenon and it's the result of positives or negatives life experience. The concept of stress is significant because it provides a way of understanding the person as a whole in life's various changes. Concept of stress. American Psychiatric Association defines stress as a sense of being overwhelmed, worried, distraction, breath, exhaustion, and lethargy. Therefore, stress can influence people in every age, sex, race, and situation, and can result in both physical and psychological health. Causes of stress. The death of loved one, divorce, loss of a job, increase in financial obligations, getting married, moving to a new home, chronic illness or injury, emotional problems such as depression, anxiety, anger, suicide, taking care of an elderly or sick family member, traumatic event such as a natural disaster, rape, violence against you and or a loved one, being unhappy in your job, having a heavy workload or too much responsibility, working long hours, having poor management, unclear expectations of your work, or no say in the decision-making process, working under dangerous conditions. Effects of stress on body system. First, central nervous and endocrine systems. Your central nervous system, CNS, is in charge of your fight or flight response. In your brain, the hypothalamus gets the ball rolling, telling your adrenal glands to release the stress hormones such as adrenaline and cortisol. These hormones, adrenaline and cortisone, increase your heartbeat and send the blood rushing to the areas that need it most in an emergency, such as muscles, heart, and other important organs. When the perceived fear is gone, the hypothalamus should tell all systems to go back to normal. If the CNS fails to return to normal or if the stressor doesn't go away, the response will continue. Second, respiratory and cardiovascular system. Stress hormones affect your respiratory and cardiovascular systems. During the stress response, you breathe faster in an effort to quickly distribute oxygen rich blood to your body. If you already have a breathing problem like asthma or emphysema, stress can make it even harder to breathe. Third, digestive system. Under stress, your liver produces extra blood sugar to give you a boost of energy. If you are under chronic stress, your body may not be able to keep up with this extra glucose. Chronic stress may increase your risk of developing type 2 diabetes. Stress can also affect the way food moves through your body, leading to diarrhea or constipation. You might also experience nausea, vomiting, or stomach ache. 4. Muscular system. Your muscles tense up to protect themselves from injury when you are stressed. They tend to release again once you relax, but if you are constantly under stress, your muscles may not get the chance to relax. Tight muscles cause headache, back and shoulder pain, and body aches. Over time, this can set off an unhealthy cycle as you stop exercising and return to pain medication for 5 sexuality and reproductive system. Stress is exhausting for both the body and mind. It's not unusual to lose your desire when you are under constant stress. While short-term stress may cause men to produce more of the male hormone testosterone, this effect doesn't last. If stress continues for a long time, a man's testosterone levels can begin to drop. This can interfere with sperm production and cause erectile dysfunction or impotence. Chronic stress may also increase risk of infection for male reproductive organs like the prostate and testes. For women, stress can affect the menstrual cycle. It can lead to irregular, heavier, or more painful periods. Chronic stress can also magnify the physical symptoms of menopause. 6. The immune system. Stress stimulates the immune system, which can be a plus for immediate situations. This stimulation can help you avoid infections and heal wounds. But over time, stress hormones will weaken your immune system and reduce your body's response to foreign invaders. People under chronic stress are more susceptible to viral illnesses like the flu and the common cold, as well as other infections. Stress can also increase the time it takes you to recover from an illness or injury. Main theories about stress. The theoretical models that have been formulated for interpreting stress are helping to identify stressors in a particular situation and predicting the possibility of an individual's adaptation to stressful situation. Three are the main theoretical approaches for stress. Each one interprets stress differently, either as a stimulus, as a response, or as a transient. Number one, stimulus-based models. In these models, the stress is interpreted as a stimulus, a life event or a group circumstances which may awaken normal and or psychological reactions which may increase the vulnerability of the individuals to disease. According to Holmes, there are 43 life events or lifestyle changes which can cause stress. According to this theory, both positive and negative life events are considered stressful. The scale of stressful life events is used to record the recent stressful experience of the individual, such as divorce, pregnancy, retirement. Ever since similar skills have been developed, however, they should be used with caution since the extent of stress which is embodied to life events depends on the way in which is interpreted by the individual. Moreover, those skills must have been validated in the age and in the socioeconomic status. In addition, they must have been culturally adapted. Number two, response-based models. In those theoretical models, stress is interpreted as a response. The definition of stress as a response was developed and described by Seeley, who defined stress as a non-specific response of the body to any kind of demands applied on it. Seeley's model is called general adaptation syndrome. Seeley, in order to differentiate the cause of stress from the response to this, introduced the term stressor, naming so any factor can cause stress and affect the balance of the individual. Seeley mentions due the fact that stress is a state of the body. It can only be observed within the changes occurring in it. This full body response, general adaptation syndrome, is manifested by releasing certain hormones which resulted in changes in the structure and the chemical composition of the body. Apart from the adaptation of the whole body, it's possible a portion reaction of the body or of an organ to take place. This response to stress is called the local adaptation syndrome. General adaptation syndrome is the three-stage process that describes the physiological changes the body goes through when under stress. Hans Seeley, a medical doctor and researcher, came up with the theory of General Adaptation Syndrome. First, to give a scientific explanation for biological stress, Hans Selye explained his stress model based on physiology and psychology as General Adaptation Syndrome. His model states that an event that threatens an organism's well-being, a stressor, leads to a three-stage bodily response. Stage 1, alarm. Stage 2, resistance. Stage 3, exhaustion. He explained about hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis system which prepares the body to cope with stress. Selye also explained about a local adaptation syndrome, which refers to the inflammatory response and the repair processes occur at the local site of tissue injury as in small topical injuries, such as contact dermatitis, which may lead to general adaptation syndrome if the local injury is severe enough. During an experiment with lab rats at university in Montreal, he observed a series of physiological changes in the rats after they were exposed to stressful event. With additional research, Selye concluded that these changes were not an isolated case, but rather the typical response to stress. Selye identified these stages as alarm, resistance, and exhaustion. Understanding these different responses and how they relate to each other may help you cope with stress. Number 1, alarm reaction stage. The alarm reaction stage refers to the initial symptoms the body experiences when under stress. You may be familiar with the fight or flight response, which is a physiological response to stress. This natural reaction prepares you to either flee or protect yourself in dangerous situation. Your heartbeat increases, your adrenal gland releases cortisol, a stress hormone, and you receive a boost of adrenaline, which increases energy. This fight or flight response occurs in the alarm reaction stage. Number 2, resistance stage. After the initial shock of a stressful event and having a fight or flight response, the body begins to repair itself. It releases a lower amount of cortisol, and your heart rate and blood pressure begin to normalize. Also, your body enters this recovery phase. It remains on high alert for a while. If you overcome stress and the situation is no longer an issue, your body continues to repair itself until your hormone levels, heart rate, and the blood pressure reach a pre-stress state. Some stressful situations continue for extended periods of time if you don't resolve the stress and your body remains on high alert. It eventually adapts and learns how to live with a higher stress level. In this stage, the body goes through changes that you are unaware of it and attempt to cope with stress. Your body continues to secrete the stress hormone, and your body pressure remains elevated. You may think you are managing stress well, but your body's physical response tells a different story. If the resistance stage continues for too long of a period without pauses to offset the effects of stress, this can lead to the exhaustion stage. Signs of the resistance stage include irritability, frustration, poor concentration. This stage is the result of prolonged or chronic stress. Struggling with stress for long periods can drain your physical, emotional, and mental resources to the point where your body no longer has strength to fight stress. You may give up or feel your situation is hopeless. Signs of exhaustion include fatigue, burnout, depression, anxiety, decreased stress tolerance. The physical effects of this stage also weaken your immune system and put you at risk for stress-related illnesses. Number 3, transaction-based models. All theoretical models that interpret stress as a transaction are based on the theory of Lazarus, who focused on the fact that there are differences among people in interpretation of stress as a stimulus or as a response. None of the previous theories according to Lazarus could exactly change factors may lead some people to manage stress properly while others are not. He stated that there is a lack in theories in the interpretation of the factors that help some people to adjust for a longer period than others into a stressful stimuli. Despite the fact that Lazarus acknowledges certain environmental conditions as causes of stress for many individuals, however, points out the people and groups of people differ in sensitivity and vulnerability to certain types of events, as well as in the interpretation and in the response to those events. For the interpretation of the diversity among individuals that are experiencing similar stressful events, Lazarus' model is taking into account the cognitive processes that mediate between stimulus and response, as well as the factors affecting these processes. Lazarus' cognitive evaluation theory focuses on the individual environment and on the stimulus cognitive evaluation of environmental demands and stimulus response options. According to this theory, a number of external and internal information arriving daily in the neurocognitive level of the body, which are interpreted by the process of cognitive evaluation. Cognitive evaluation is the process of judgment by which the level of adjustment missions available that each person has is recognized. It includes identifying available resources and options, which will help the person to negotiate with potential or actual demands. Upon the initial requirements evaluation, some can be assessed as irrelevant and other as very stressful or as positive. Stress, according to this theory, is a process in which requirements outweigh the adaptive capacities of the individual. The requirements can be either external or internal. This is a picture about the effects of stress on all body systems. Medical management. Medical management of stress. Individuals who are stressed and anxious can benefit from these therapies. Social support, psychotherapy, cognitive or behavioral therapy, pharmacotherapy, supportive counseling, anxiety related to unconscious conflict about essential goals and values of life, threat to self-concept, positive or negative self-talk, or physiological factors, hyperthyroidism, pulmonary embolism, dysrhythmia. Stress management techniques. The following stress management techniques have been constantly supported by empirical research: physical activity and exercise, healthy eating, adequate sleep, relaxation, mindfulness and meditation, laughter, self-expression, and social support and cognitive restructuring. Diaphragmatic breathing or deep abdominal breathing is a technique designed to slow one's breath and regulate oxygen intake. Diaphragmatic breathing involves taking slow, deep breaths with the intention of expanding and contracting the diaphragm, which is a muscle separating the chest and abdominal cavities. Typically, diaphragmatic breathing involves sitting in a comfortable chair or lying down and taking slow, deep breaths with the intention of breathing so that the air expands the abdomen more than the chest. Research suggested that practicing diaphragmatic breathing can significantly reduce perceived stress. Study: progressive muscle relaxation refers to a series of techniques that involves the repeated tensing and relaxing of various muscle groups in the body. Often deep breathing is integrated whereby an individual undergoes a deep breathing exercise while also tensing and relaxing muscle groups. Progressive muscle relaxation sessions typically involve assuming a comfortable position and taking deep breaths while tensing and relaxing 16 different muscle groups, starting with the head muscles and working down the body before ending with the feet. Guided imagery or visualization refers to a type of relaxation training that involves the use of language to create calming, sensory-rich experiences in one's imagination. guided imagery techniques can vary widely, most involve guiding an individual toward places or situations in which they feel calm and comfortable, and individuals are encouraged to free their minds of any interfering thoughts or daily concerns. For example, a session might consist of having an individual imagine that they are sitting on a quiet beach on a perfect weather day or in the woods next to a gentle flowing stream. Research suggests that guided imagery techniques are effective in reducing stress and enhancing positive mood states. Guided imagery has also been shown to enhance feelings of well-being and calmness among individuals with a variety of chronic diseases. Meditation exercises focusing on a specific object or sensation, such as breathing, while disengaging from other distractors and regulating internal experiences, emotions, thoughts, through non-judgmental acceptance. Research suggests that meditation is negatively correlated with perceived stress and decreases in serum cortisol levels, a stress hormone. Further, meditation is positively associated with a variety of relaxation markers, such as reduces skeletal muscle metabolism, higher skin resistance, decreased heart rate, and increased alpha wave activity. It's also associated with enhanced sociability, empathy, and positive self. Laughter is the best medicine. Indeed, we now know that laughter produces many positive physiological and psychological changes in the body. Research indicates that laugh increases oxygen intake and stimulates various muscles and organs, including the heart and lung. Laughing also reduces blood pressure and blood sugar levels, increases blood flow, and improves energy levels. In addition, laughing causes the release of endorphins, which can increase pain tolerance and induce feelings of euphoria. Humor provides a psychological distance from the current state and enables us to replace your negative appraisals with more positive ones. In fact, some research suggests that laughing may be as effective as mild aerobic exercise or relaxing training at improving mood. In addition, laughter causes the release of endorphins, which can increase pain tolerance and induce feelings of euphoria. Humor provides a psychological distance from the current state and enables us to release our negative appraisals with more positive ones. In fact, some research suggests that laughter may be as effective as mild aerobic exercise or relaxation training at improving mood. A strong social support. A strong social support system is also helpful when coping with stress. Research suggests that the strength of one's social support network is a predictor of health and is negatively associated with many mental health problems. In contrast, loneliness is associated with a variety of health problems, including high blood pressure, and lonely individuals have many more stressful experiences and are more likely to assess situations as stressful. Researchers theorize that higher levels of perceived stress may explain the poorer health conditions of lonely individuals. Further, they have found loneliness mediates the relationship between social support and health. Loneliness is best protected against with the quality or closeness of relationships over quantity or number of relationships. Thus, effort should be put towards meaningful relationships rather than countless peripheral ones. Cognitive restructuring. As you can see, the way that we perceive or think about a situation or event can dramatically affect the emotions we experience. Cognitive restructuring involves learning to recognize the irrational or maladaptive thoughts we experience that contribute to negative mood states, and then altering them to more accurately reflect the situation. For example, if you are preparing for a presentation and you repeatedly think, I know I am going to say something stupid and everyone will laugh at me, or everyone is going to be able to see how anxious I am and they will think I am an idiot. You will likely be fairly. However, are these rational thoughts, unless you are particularly adept at foretelling the future, in which case I would appreciate some help selecting many lottery numbers. These thoughts are likely examples of catastrophic thoughts which serve to increase anxiety. Although it is possible that you will say something stupid, what are the chances if you thoroughly prepare and rehearse your presentation? How many times have you given a presentation in the past and not said anything stupid, even if you do say something that doesn't sound particularly intellectual? Is it possible that some, most or all of the people in the class might not notice or think negatively about you? If people do notice your anxiety, is it possible that they might interpret it in a different way than assuming you are an idiot? Might some people not have empathy for you, considering that public speaking is one of the greatest fears among college students? After challenging the irrational or maladaptive thoughts in this manner, it's important to select a rational alternative to substitute. A more rational alternative to the first assumption might be, if I prepare well and know what I am going to say in advance, I will probably do a fine job of delivering the presentation. For the second statement, you might substitute, most people will be anxious when they present, and even if they do not my anxiety, they will probably be able to relate to it. Research suggests that cognitive restructuring, or learning to recognize maladaptive thoughts and change them to reflect more adaptive rational thought patterns, can significantly improve mood, reduce stress, and reduce negative emotions. Nursing management. Nursing assessment assess level of anxiety, review familial and physiological factors, genetic depressive factor, psychiatric illness, active medical conditions, thyroid problems, metabolic imbalances, monitor vital signs, description of feelings expressed and displayed, conduct interview and observe behavior, awareness and ability to recognize and express feelings, related substance use if present. Nursing diagnosis anxiety related to unconscious conflict about essential goals and values of life. 3. To self-concept, positive or negative self-talk, or psychological physiological factors such as hyperthyroidism, pulmonary embolism, dysarrhythmia. Nursing intervention assist clients to identify feelings and begin to deal with problems. Establish a therapeutic relationship. Be available to client for listening and talking. Assist the client to develop self-awareness of verbal and nonverbal behaviors. Clarify meaning of feelings and actions by providing feedback and checking meaning with client. Most of all, acknowledge anxiety and fear. When dealing with children, be truthful and avoid bribing. Promote wellness. Assist the client with identifying new methods of coping with disabling anxiety. Review having thoughts and feelings preceding the anxiety attack. List helpful resources and people. Assist in developing skills. Awareness of negative thoughts, saying stop and substituting a positive thought. How to cope better with stress. People can learn to manage stress and lead healthier lives. Here are some tips to help you keep stress at bay. Keep a positive attitude. Accept that there are events that you can't control. Be assertive instead of aggressive. Assert your feelings, opinions, or beliefs instead of becoming angry, defensive, or passive. Learn and practice relaxation techniques. try meditations, yoga for stress management. Exercise regularly, your body can fight stress better when it's fit. Eat healthy, well-balanced meals, learn to manage your time more effectively, set limits appropriately, and learn to say no to requests that would create excessive stress on your life. Make time for hobbies, interests, and relaxation. Get enough rest and sleep. Your body needs time to recover from stressful events. Don't rely on alcohol, drugs, or compulsive behaviors to reduce it. Seek out social support. Spend enough time with those you enjoy. Seek treatment with a psychologist or other mental health professional trained in stress management. Suppressing negative feelings can increase stress and be detrimental to one's health. However, research suggests that expressing negative emotions in an adaptive and socially acceptable manner can serve to reduce stress and improve immune function.